I wanted to talk to you about what we're doing in particular in healthcare, but I'm going to back up a little and tell you a little bit about how I got to where we are today. Hopefully that'll give you a better appreciation of where we might apply this in the near future. So in a sense, we'll be talking about software that partially understands and the impact of that on the AI, the artificial intelligence in medicine dream. So I want to go back 40-some years and talk about probably the single most profound impact of any movie was 2001 on me when I was a teenager. Marvin Minsky and Stanley Kubrick took Arthur C. Clarke's vision from The Sentinel and turned it into something where obviously the all sorts of interesting characters from ape men to spacemen and so on, but by far the dominating character was the HAL 9000 computer. And the idea of a computer that could be intelligent, that could carry on a conversation with you, that could help you amplify your brain power, creativity, problem-solving ability, that could change everything. That would change everything. And now, 40-some years later, I feel exactly the same way. So the question is, where are we now? It's well after 2001. Did we get there? Well, obviously the answer is no. And people like the semantic web people are still saying something which is equivalent to that same dream, if only we could have something like that. And what's the reality? The reality is something more like this. So this is Mary Shepherd, who's not only a co-worker and spouse, but also is a quilter. And here she's buying something on eBay, a ribbon master pleater, and she didn't actually get it. But eBay, trying to be helpful, says, would you actually like to see similar items? So she says yes. And then you see four or five things here which have absolutely nothing to do with being a ribbon master pleater. And if you look very carefully, you can figure out like why it included them. And it's pretty much because this has the phrase never been used, and these happen to have the phrase never been used. So this is like really, really pathetic. This is a far cry from Tim Berners-Lee's dream. This is a far cry from the 2001 dream. Here's an even simpler, sort of painful example I've been using for several years, which is how old was Jenna Bush when her father took office? And you can ask Google or Ask or anything. You won't get the answer. Of course you'll get things like when she was born and when her father took office and so on. And then you as a human being are able to calculate how old she was in January of 2001. Essentially because you know things that age 1 year per year, that's sort of not really deep. And so you can perform complicated operations like subtraction and get the answer to that. It's really pathetic that computers can't do that today. So today I'll talk to you about a program that can actually answer that kind of question. It's a kind of question that you really need to know a little bit about common sense, a little bit about time, a little bit about natural language in order to answer. So I'm going to start back a little farther, back in 1984, and when we started the Psych project 26 years ago. And it was essentially a reaction to the brittleness of expert systems at that time. So what do I mean by brittleness? I mean things like we had car loan approval expert systems that would blithely approve a loan for someone who said that they had worked at the same job for 30 years, even though they also said they were born in 1980 or something like that. Or Alain Bonnet's skin disease diagnosis expert system, which actually did fairly well, but as a joke, we told it about my rusted out old Pontiac station wagon. And it asked questions, are there spots on the body? Yes. More on the trunk than elsewhere? No. What color are they? Reddish brown. Eventually diagnosed the car as having measles. And so there's a lot of like humor there, but it's not really that funny if it's like your life or your property that's at stake. Going even farther back to something that was done right about here, namely Joe Weizenbaum's ELISA program, sometimes now called the Doctor program, that was done at MIT in the mid-60s. Back when Rogerian psychology was very popular, This is where you do reflection. So the patient would say, I'm trying to quit smoking. And you'd say, tell me more about the fact that you're trying to quit smoking, or something like that. One of my favorite examples with that is when we said to the program, my dog's mother died recently, and it said back, tell me more about your mother. So this is one of these situations where the more you know about computers, the less deep this psychiatric insight looks. Because obviously what's going on under the covers is that it doesn't really understand the word dog, and it's just hearing blah, 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 mother, and then it says, tell me more about your mother. This is sort of like the Gary Larson Far Side cartoon, remember, of like what you say to the dog and what the dog actually hears. And for those of you that are dog people, I'll show you the rarely seen cat version of this, which is what you say to the cat and what the cat actually hears. But anyway, so this was, like 40-some years ago, so maybe things have gotten better, but it's really very sad that things were that brittle. So 1970s, expert systems came along. Again, the promise of doing a medical consultation, medical decision making, or at least helping with that. But the reality, some success, but very, very brittle. Abdominal pain advisor was one of the very first around 1971, 72. Popel and Myers internist. Ted Shortliff, Ed Feigenbaum, Josh Lederberg doing Meissen and some other programs, and lots more, and so on. And in general, these programs, this is a typical Meissen rule. Meissen was good at doing antimicrobial therapy. It was good at telling you what kind of meningitis someone was suffering from, like fungal, bacterial, viral, and actually did extremely well compared to most doctors. The trouble is that if a patient came in presenting with appendicitis, it would tell you which kind of meningitis they were most likely suffering from. John McCarthy, as a joke, told it about someone who was dead, and it blithely recommended ampicillin and chloramphenicol for the person. So basically, it was a kind of idiot savant. It was better than doctors in some ways, but obviously not something that you would entrust an actual human being's life to or well-being to, because it didn't have common sense, it didn't have a broad enough understanding of medicine to entrust it to. So that's what I mean by brittleness. The same is really true in the 1980s. The same is true in the 90s, the 2000s, and so on. And so here it is, 40-some years after ELISA. And what is the state of question answering and natural language understanding today? It is the same pathetic ELISA-like state that it was back then. So you say things like, what's the color of a blue car? And you get some horrible garbled answer. And this is the winner of the latest Turing test competition, which is this little chatbot called Alice. One of my favorite interactions with Alice, by the way, is when we said, where is Sue's nose when Sue is in her house? And we expected it to say, like, on her face or something. But what it said was, where it belongs. Now, this is actually not a terrible answer, but it ruined it by going on to say, try searching the World Wide Web. So obviously, it's just matching, where is X or something. So anyway, this is, sort of sad. But anyway, so the reason I'm not going to tell you as much about using our system to answer clinical researchers' questions is that when Renata asked me a year ago what I wanted to talk about, this was the main topic. But we have a paper which is coming out essentially in about a month, which I'll be happy to make sure that all of you get a copy of. So if you want to see sort of the 20-page version of what I was going to talk about in detail, then I'll make sure that you get that. I need to see there's some folks from Cleveland Clinic and some folks from Cycorp that wrote this and so on. I'll tell you a little bit about this, but I'm going to use this opportunity to give you a more general picture of how we're able to do this. And when I say how we're able to do this, I mean not just handling 3- and 4-word sentences, but handling 30, 40, 200-word questions that are complicated like this. So the basic idea is something like the following. The investigator types in a query, which can be a fairly sophisticated query. We don't really understand it. Anybody that tells you they can understand those kinds of queries is pretty much lying. What we can do is we can partially parse it. We can recognize fragments. We can recognize entities. We can recognize relationships. We can convert this long query into a series of almost like Mad Lib fill-in-the-blank partial parses. And then we present a list of those partial parses to the doctor. And we say, is this part of what you meant? Is that part of what you meant? Is that? And they just sort of say, yes, yes, no, yes, no. Now we have a series of almost like jigsaw puzzle pieces, and we have to fit them together. But there are all sorts of constraints, almost like the shape of jigsaw puzzle pieces, that helps us fit them together. Some of those constraints are domain knowledge. Some of them are common sense knowledge. Some of it is context knowledge of what the person was recently asking about. Some of it is discourse knowledge, just rules of sort of common discourse conventions we have. Like, you wouldn't say it this way if you really, you know, like if I say, do you know what time it is? And you say yes, that's not really an appropriate discourse response, and so on. So given all of that, a really cool thing happens most of the time, which is there's only one single meaningful way that these selected puzzle pieces can be put together into a semantically meaningful, coherent question. And then we paraphrase that back into English for them. They say, hopefully, yes. Then we go off and dispatch that to different databases and get the answer to their question. So as I said, this is sort of the general architecture. We have a long article about this that I can make sure that you all get. And when I talk about clinical researchers asking for this, that was the original motivation for that. That was the original source of funding for this. But in fact, very often clinicians can ask the same sorts of questions, not because they're interested in finding patterns in populations of patient data, but because they're interested in applying those patterns to the particular patient he or she is seeing that day. So why is it hard for our programs to understand natural language? Even simple natural language utterances. So these are sort of cute garden path sentences, and maybe it's understandable why it would be hard to get a program to not be fooled by these, because most people are fooled by these, because you start to read them, and then you realize you have to go back and read them again to understand them. Or, you know, if I showed you sort of like cute puns or joke things, or one of my favorite signs that outside a bar is this one, which is, you know, for the last 20 years it said free beer tomorrow and stuff like that.